This podcast is part of the Big Heads Media Podcast Network. Go to bigheadsmedia.com for more great podcasts.
Welcome to Brew Crime. I'm Mike.
And I'm Beck.
And I'm Nina.
And we have a special guest with us today. Can you introduce yourself, please?
No. I'm just kidding. I'm CJ. I'm from Beyond the Rainbow. True Crimes of the LGBT.
Perfect. All right. Well, this is our first attempt at a episode that's recorded remotely. So forgive us if the audio quality kind of stutters or goes weird because we don't know what the hell we're doing.
Yeah, we're not drunk. It's because we're on a Zoom call, I promise.
Yeah, no.
I'm drunk.
We'll be drunk later.
I'm getting drunk.
Yeah. Perfect. All right, so this episode, we're going to be doing celebrity crimes. I think we're going to start first with Nina.
Yeah, so I'm going to kick us off today. For the celebrities episode, the one I decided to focus on was Jeffrey Duncan Jones. He's more commonly known as Jeffrey Jones. He's known for his roles as Emperor Joseph II in Amadeus, and he was also the principal in Ferris Bueller's Day Off, and obviously my favorite, he was Charles Dietz in Beetlejuice. And for those who don't know who that is, it's Winona Ryder's dad.
No way.
Yeah, for those of you who don't know what Beetlejuice is, you've wasted your life so far, and you really need to watch that movie.
Or you're really young.
No excuse.
None at all. Oh. Great movie.
Bad human being.
It happens.
Yeah, my story is not terribly long today, but a little bit of background on him. He was born September 28th in 1946. So he's roughly 73 now. I don't know. He's old as shit. in Buffalo, New York. And I wrote Beautiful USA because it felt right at the time.
Lots of parts are beautiful.
Some parts are beautiful and some parts have Trump supporters. So,
right?
Yep.
I'm just going to jump right into his legal troubles. In 2002, he was arrested for the possession of child pornography. At the time, he was accused by a 17-year-old boy for solicitation to post for nude photographs. When the offense had actually occurred, the boy, the minor, he was actually only 14 years old. So it took a couple of years for the child to come forward to just talk about the experience. Jeffrey tried multiple times to solicit this particular kid. I tried to do a little bit of research to just find out who this child was and who he was in relation to Jeffrey Jones, and I couldn't find anything. I'm assuming, obviously, it's a minor, so his name's protected.
Probably.
Yeah, absolutely. So that makes sense, but I mean, obviously, it doesn't change who the victim was.
No, of course not.
Right.
So Jeffrey pled no contest to the charge of soliciting a minor. And the misdemeanor charge of possession of child pornography was dropped. Jeffrey's attorney did emphasize, and I think it's important to point it out, that there's technically no improper physical contact. It was just him trying to solicit the minor for nude photographs. So I think it's important to give out that extension, because usually when we talk about these kind of events, there's some kind of contact with the minor that's also inappropriate, as physical or touching or whatever. I'm not going to spell it out, but there was none of that. So I don't know if that's better or worse. It's still not right, but maybe not as awful.
Yeah, that's more accurate. It's not as awful.
It's not as Nina,
did they say if it was mostly male children or female children in his pornography collection?
From what I saw, it was male, young males. Oh. Yeah, male or female. I mean, obviously.
Right. I was just curious.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. So what his punishment was, he received only 5 years of probation, a requirement for counseling, and to register as a sex offender. From here, I tried to see if he had any other offenses after this sentencing, and there were two more offenses. However, both were just in relation to him not re-registering as a sex offender when either he was moving or when they have to do the scheduled updates. It was interesting going through like his Wikipedia and looking at his filmography. You can definitely see between, you know, the 1980s and early 1990s, he had like year after year, this movie, that movie, this episode, that. And then after 2002, you see a straight drop. Obviously, my assumption is it's because of the charge, right?
Oh, probably got blacklisted, yeah.
Well, yeah.
It is what it is, right? So I think that's fine. Since 2002, he's only had three movies accredited to him since that time. One show, television show, is what picked him up, called Deadwood. I haven't heard of that.
Yeah, I've heard of that.
Yeah, so
that's a Western, I think, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
It's a what?
It's a Western. That's actually quite a good show.
Yeah, so he was in 33 episodes with those guys, but while he was recording Deadwood is one of the times he got arrested because he didn't re-register as a sex offender. Other than that, he hasn't really done much work since. While doing this research, it kind of got me thinking of, well, what about like other people that have committed crimes that are like that famous? Because for Beetlejuice, that's a pretty well-known movie for the time it came out, and obviously still there's a huge fandom behind it. But I feel that there was a direct impact of his allegation and charge and his sentencing to his decline of getting work. So, for example, like what I'm trying to say is he didn't get more famous afterwards. What was interesting to me is looking at Jay-Z. Obviously, we all know who Jay-Z is, the rapper who's married to Beyonce, whatever. Yes. It's interesting. So I don't know how many people know, but in 1999, Jay-Z was actually arrested and pled guilty to stabbing someone. So what he ended up getting charged with was third-degree assault. He stabbed someone with a 5-inch blade inside a nightclub and admitted to it.
I'm not surprised, actually, just from the whole industry he's part of.
But see, that's what I'm saying, though, right? So that's great you say that, Mike, because I feel like because he's in this like gangster, you know, industry, and he's a rapper, gives him street credit, but he literally stabbed someone because he thought this person leaked one of his like mixtapes, whatever, early.
Hmm.
He is soaring. He's a billionaire now. Everyone loves him. I have nothing against Jay-Z or anything. I think it's more just how society's interpretation. Well, he's a gangster, so obviously he'd be involved in some kind of drug crime. That makes sense. Makes sense.
Right, like it was expected to happen at some point.
Obviously, right? So, yeah. Well, not obviously, but obviously, right? Like,
No, I know what you mean, yeah.
He talks about, like, selling dope. Talks about, well, obviously here, he pled guilty to this third-degree assault. Talked about literally stabbing someone in a club. I mean, I'm laughing, but, like, it's serious. That's insane.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's still associated with major brands. His career, if anything, since 1999, has obviously skyrocketed.
Yep. So he basically got his street creds for being a thug, mm-hmm. right?
Yep.
And it just made him a more popular celebrity.
Well, I didn't see anything from the brief search I did where this particular sentence held him back from anything. Or where any
we're talking about Jay-Z, not Jeffrey Jones, right?
Yeah,
okay. And I'm really
Jeffrey Jones stabbed someone in a nightclub because someone released his mixtape early.
Sorry, I guess I didn't really think that went through.
Yeah. His mixtape would be really scary.
You're probably right.
It was just interesting to compare. Obviously, I understand that they're in different levels of entertainment, I suppose, but regardless, from what I saw at first glance, you know, it doesn't look like Jay-Z was at all affected by this. It was more as like, that's a part of the street cred. That's a part of just what being a gangster is, you know, stabbing people in the clubs because we're fucking morons. It's fine. But yeah,
I got to tell you, I'm a little surprised that Jeffrey Jones didn't come out in the Me Too movement like Kevin Spacey did.
Yeah, really? He did.
Well, his name didn't come up.
Well, that's the thing. So when I was looking into Jeffrey Jones, I couldn't find anything where he actually had a physical relationship. I don't want to say relationship, but had physical contact with whether it's a minor or anyone for that matter. And that was seen.
That's true.
Whatever, right? Like, I think there is a distinction between someone looking at child pornography
and someone acting on it. Yeah.
Who's taking the physical picture. And then obviously the person in between who's sharing the pictures on the internet so people like whatever can get access to it. Obviously, I think none of it is right in that whole circle, right? In that whole life cycle or whatever. But I couldn't find anything where he actually physically touched or harmed a child Obviously, viewing images is still a type of harm, and it's an offense, and it's awful. But I'm assuming in the Me Too, like, there was discussion. His name came up because he's a registered sex offender. But from all I see, he's never recommitted.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if he was collecting the pictures, then he is causing people to be offended against because people have to create more photos for more monsters, right?
Yeah.
So he's still involved regardless, yeah. And how much you want to bet he's still collecting the shit now?
Ooh, probably, huh?
Yeah, I didn't see anything that he was sharing the photos, but it's his personal collection, and I feel awkward even using the word personal. But I think it is obviously still an offense, but I think there are different caveats to it.
I think he would have victimized a child himself if he had the chance, so he's still just a bigger monster.
Yeah, I don't know that I agree with that, right? Like, there was no evidence of him ever doing that, but who knows, right? Like, what if this child didn't come forward? What could it have led to, right?
Yeah.
But thankfully, we don't need to hypothesize about something like that because, a brave child did come forward and there was sentencing, and it was nice to see that there wasn't a debate of him saying, no, I didn't do it. He did plead guilty to it, right?
Yeah.
So I think that shows some level of humanity, even if that doesn't make sense. I don't know. It's not right by any means.
I get what you're saying. It, like, what he did, obviously, is wrong. That when he was caught, he was just like, yeah, I did it.
Yeah, I fucked up. I should have done
sorry.
It.
And that he hasn't recommitted, that's all good, you know. But, like, why isn't he fulfilling his registration duties?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
But I don't know. It's hard to get a job if you have to do that. It's hard to live in certain communities, right? From what I saw, you know, he's married with kids.
Well, he shouldn't be allowed to be around kids, period.
He should be in therapy because that's a mental illness.
Yeah.
And he had court-appointed counseling, and from everything I saw, he attended all of it. He did all of it, right?
Oh, good, good.
Although I think it's probably like a lot of addiction issues or whatever, or therapy for mental health. It's a lifelong thing. It's not something you can just stop.
True. And I'm not saying he stopped. I just didn't see any reports that he didn't say that he continued or didn't continue afterwards.
Yeah.
But, you know, it kind of goes back to, we have the people set the rules, and he did everything according that was sent, that his sentencing was, that happened. So this is what our criminal justice system, what we expected it to do. He followed by those rules after admission of his guilt and all of that. And now he's a free citizen and he still has to register. He's misregistered twice. And you know what? It never shows what the reasons are. It could very well be that he missed it maybe by 2 days. I don't know. Maybe they have within 20 days of moving, you have to do it. And he missed it in that, right?
Right.
There's something that we found that he was like running away from the law and chasing them and, you know, nothing that big. But it's a lot of unknowns in there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but anyways, yeah, I guess my biggest thing about it was not cool what he did, but interesting to see that his treatment within the industry, let's say, basically went to like nothing. He's not important. And then just randomly coming across some of the Jay-Z stuff and seeing like, oh, wow, well, his street cred definitely skyrocketed after that. And he's now a billionaire on a boat in a yacht somewhere with Beyonce. So,
yep.
You know, well, and it's... like you were saying with Jay-Z, it was the lifestyle, you know, how he represents himself. But what I don't understand is, what was that, Nina?
It shouldn't make a difference, right? Like, I thought maybe lifestyle from him was expected. But then to me also, like, does that make us, what does that make us? Well, you're a gangster, so we expect you to be stabbing people and selling dope.
Yeah.
That's fucked up. That's fucked up. That's our default, right? Where it's like, oh, it's not as bad because... you grew up in the ghetto, you sold drugs, you know, you're...
Yeah.
It's a bunch of stereotypes that we're throwing in to justify, like, oh, well, that's just who you are. Good for coming out of those conditions.
Yeah, all I was going to say was, it's very clear that what this Jeffrey Jones guy did heavily impacted his career.
Yeah.
But there's other dirtbags in, like, Hollywood or in the music industry who are doing it all the time. And it just... no impact.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And people just cover it up or...
I just definitely think a turn has happened in the last 5-6 years. Obviously, you know, CJ, I know you mentioned like the Me Too movement, but just the social publicity that some are getting, and one victim steps forward and then a bunch, like Bill Cosby or thing with John before, right? So
Harvey Weinstein.
Absolutely.
R. Kelly.
I think society is changing where before, and this is my interpretation of it, but before women were like frowned upon or shamed, right? Like, I can't believe I let this happen to me. You know what? Maybe I shouldn't have been out drinking. Maybe, and now it's just more like, fuck you. I can do whatever I want. You're the one who did the bad thing. But it takes decades. It takes generations of changing that whole mindset, right? So who knows? I'm sure there's more bad shit that happened back in the, 1980s and 1990s that we haven't heard about yet.
Oh, yeah. We'll probably never hear about some of it.
Yeah, and I think that's a really shitty reality to come to, but it's got to be right? And I don't know. Bill Cosby was a fucking big one for me. Fucking loved the Cosby Show and all of that. Unreal.
Right.
Genuinely loved it. I mean, I remember freaking starting to watch it before I even learned how to speak English. Well, but no, right? Like, that was a big thing. He was like, fucking hilarious. And now it's just like, he ruined it. You know, that part he ruined that, like, idea of, whatever, right? So even with Harvey Weinstein, right? Like, I've watched some of the movies which women got parts because of what happened or whatever, right? It's just such a big mindfuck to deal with that. But anyways, that's my fun story.
Well, fuck.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's just, it's not acceptable behavior. And I praise all the people who are coming up, women and men, to say that, you know what, this is something that happened to me and they're dealing with it now. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's good that we're leaning in the direction where it's not just that victims aren't being blamed. It's that they're being believed.
Yeah, finally.
Right.
You know, I think there's finally a platform where victims can openly talk about what happened. There goes a lot to just being heard. It's not like I can't speak for everyone, but I think sometimes it's just about having like an experience acknowledged to be like, no, this did happen and come on. Right. So,
All right. Well, we'll get ready for the next one then. All right. So my story is on the murder suicide of the Barsi family. In 1956, there was an uprising in the Hungarian People's Republic, now known as just Hungary. Many people fled the country, including both Joseph István Barsi and Maria Viravats. Neither knew each other, but they would end up both immigrating to the United States and both end up in California. Joseph would meet Maria at a restaurant where she was working as a server. They'd begin a relationship, and in the end, they would get married. This would not be the first marriage for either person, but that was in the past. On June 6, 1978, they would welcome a child into the world. The small 5-pound, 7-ounce girl was named Judith Eva Barsi, and she was born in Los Angeles.
That is small.
Yeah. That's like twin size almost.
Yeah.
Judith would spend her time attending Nevada Avenue Elementary School. She loved to spend time swimming when she could. She would also love to play in the sprinkler with her friends. I love the fact that her all-time favorite game was Operation, even though she was not really good at it.
Who was?
It's just, you know, it's a fun game.
I was good at everything I ever did, so probably me.
Bullshit.
Salami bologna, I held to you.
You're not good at drinking beers that we like.
Do you guys remember that game, Perfection?
No.
Where you'd like press the base down and you had to put all the shapes or letters or whatever in, and then it would like buzz and pop up if you ran out of time.
Oh, I think I remember that, yeah.
Oh my God, heart attack.
I hate timed games.
Yeah.
See, if I don't do well the first time I do a game, I just never do it again because I'm not a loser. So I just don't ever try again.
No, that makes sense.
So I'm great at everything I do because I only do the things I know. You might say stupid, but I call it strategy.
Well, that makes sense. So with her parents both being from Hungary originally, they would teach Judith how to speak fluent Hungarian. Life would dramatically change for this young girl, though, when she was at a roller rink in San Fernando Valley with her mother. She was only 5 and a half in 1983, but she was mistaken for a 3-year-old because of her small size, and this was where she was discovered. This chance meeting led to Judith's first commercial job.
Ever since Mom and Dad found out that Donald Duck is 100% pure orange juice, They've been acting kind of funny. I mean, I know it tastes good, but really?
Honest, a giant green gorilla drink it all up.
Oh, please. We don't know what to do with them anymore. Oh, well, maybe it's just a phase.
Donald Duck, the 100% pure orange juice in the new juice block. Easy to store and open. Microwavable, too.
So that was their very first commercial spot at 5 years old. Kind of adorable sounding. So,
hey, I was a former child actor.
Were you?
I did commercials. I was the Bratz, the Chloe Bratz doll in the first like 5 commercials.
No way.
My mom pimped me out.
We have to find these commercials.
I can't find it anywhere, thank God, and I have tried. I do have an IMDb created for me, which someone has to create. You can't create it yourself. Thank you. And in a movie I did, that's a little exaggerating. In like a 3-second clip, I was in an entire movie where I was Santa's lever. And I got to talk in Serbian. And what was funny is no one on set knew anything in Serbian, so I just talked gibberish.
Why did you have to speak in Serbian then?
Because I was Santa's true believer. So they had like a scene where they had a bunch of like cut screens of like the television of children submitting their wishes to Santa. And because we're going across the world, I was in Serbia. Mm-hmm. So I got to see what I wanted from Santa in Serbian. And I was like, I want a big teddy bear with big eyes. Yeah. But if I audition, I just talk fucking bullshit.
You're a star.
Hey, you sound so authentic. My kids, because I was born there. But anyways.
This commercial spot would have Maria really push her daughter to become an actor. Well, she did just that with her commercial work. Coming in between 70 and 100 commercials in her short career.
Wow.
Her mother did make sure that she had a fairly regular childhood, though, and would ensure that she had a traditional Hungarian meal for every day at school. I thought that was just kind of a fun little fact.
That's cute.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how that went over with her classmates, though, because kids are basically jerks. But...
Oh, of course, yeah.
You know, I just want to say real quick, my daughter, I was the stage mom for my daughter. When she was 7, she had an agent that she was with in Los Angeles. And she was actually in a movie. And the trailer for it, she's in the trailer for it with words. And the kids were really excited about it because it was all over MTV and Nickelodeon at the time.
That's cool.
And she'd go to school and they'd be... Dakota, I saw your movie last night. It wasn't really her movie. It was just the trailer. But nobody wanted to break that to him.
Yeah, whatever,
but right? it was really a cool thing for her at the time.
That's awesome.
Although, there, you know what? You're right. You do have the jerks. Oh, you think you're hot because you're in a movie. That kind of shit.
Yeah. I was in the newspaper once.
I didn't mean that part about the kids being jerks. I meant Mike had said that the mom would pack her authentic Hungarian lunches for school.
Uh-huh.
And kids will make fun of you for anything that's different, right?
Yeah. Oh, food, yes. Yes, yeah. You're right.
Your mom likes you and actually takes care of you and gives you lunches. Tell her to get a job, bitch.
Oh, my God, Nina.
That was good. All right.
You were the bully, weren't you, Nina?
I was actually never the bully. Are you kidding me? Fuck, you guys both know my mom. She would kill me if I was a bully.
That's so true. That's so true.
Over the next year, in 1984, she would get a part in a TV miniseries called Fatal Vision, where she played a 3-year-old, Kimberly. Yes, a 6-year-old was playing a 3-year-old. That's just how tiny she was. Between 1984 and 1988, she would act in 25 TV shows and movies. It's like 4 years. How? Her biggest roles would be Jaws the Revenge, her adorable portrayal of Ducky from The Land Before Time, and then her last movie that came out after her death in 1989, All Dogs Go to Heaven.
Hello. I said hello. What is your name? Maybe you cannot talk yet, huh? Huh?
Don't you know anything? Long necks don't talk to, or whatever you are.
Me? I'm a long neck too, see? And I have a long tail like you. All right. I am not a long neck. I am a big mouth. But I am all alone. I am.
I remember that movie. I loved that movie when I was younger. Anyone else?
I only saw it once.
I don't know if I could watch it now. Watching some of the video clips, it doesn't look as good as I remember, but it was really cute. At the beginning of the fourth grade in 1988, she was bringing in $100,000 a year, and this is how the family purchased a three-bedroom home in the West Hills neighborhood of Los Angeles. Could you imagine? 1988, she's bringing in $100,000 a year.
It would be so weird to be that young and be making that much money. And like, how do you say to your parents, could you stop spending all my money?
Well, and it was after Macaulay Culkin got destroyed by his parents that they finally passed some laws.
Yeah.
So as I'm just looking at pictures of her, and like, I'm hormonal right now because it's that time. And I'm just like, I want one. She's so cute.
She is very cute. Yes.
Anyways.
It was also at this time that Judith began to get hormone injections at UCLA, as she was only 3'8", and they were hoping this would help her into a growth spurt.
Sorry, what age was this?
This was fourth grade. So what is fourth grade again?
Nine,
yeah.
Yeah.
Because of just how small she would always be cast as characters that were far younger than her age, such as 7 or 8 when she was 10.
Did she have some kind of medical condition?
I didn't find anything saying that, but I would guess that she might have. Unfortunately, she didn't live long enough to really find out, I think.
Yeah, I looked into this too, just curiosity before, and I couldn't find anything, any kind of condition or anything, but I think it was more just the type of roles they wanted her in. She didn't fit into that suit or that size, I guess, right? So, I don't know. It's kind of interesting, like hormone injections, like you'll get your growth spurt when you get it. That's insane to me.
Yeah.
Right. I just was wondering, because I think the girl from The Exorcist, didn't she have some kind of liver or kidney disease that stunted her growth?
Oh, I'm not sure.
I'm thinking of the right actress.
Yeah, I forget what it was. I know she was misdiagnosed at first.
I'm Googling.
Something to do with her liver. And she was misdiagnosed at first, and then she ended up dying because of the misdiagnosis.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, that whole film is cursed.
That is true.
It is. We could do a whole episode on that cursed film.
And add Poltergeist to it also. That one's cursed as well.
Linda Blair.
Was it her?
No.
I have no idea.
Linda Blair was the girl in Exorcist.
Right, but is she the one that had the stunted growth? You know who I'm talking about.
Maybe it was the girl from Poltergeist.
Linda Blair's
that I'm thinking of.
I have no idea.
Heather O'Rourke? I don't think her growth was stunted. There's another actress, and I kind of want to say she was in the original Vacation movie with Chevy Chase.
I don't know. Listeners, I'm sure, are yelling at us
right now. Probably. You dummy. This is who it was. Yeah.
Heather Michelle O'Rourke. She was in The Poltergeist. She was born in 75. She died in 88.
Yeah.
She would have been.
I think that's 12. Who I was thinking of.
That's not who I was thinking of. I'm sorry.
No, don't. You're apologizing because I said the wrong person that you were talking about. Which one of us is the Canadian here?
Exactly.
Yeah, so she had flu-like symptoms, had cardiac arrest, weren't able to help her. They thought she had an acute bowel obstruction and died 2 hours into surgery. She ended up having a disease in the intestine and then septic shock, went into septic shock and passed away.
Jeez. That's who I was thinking of for sure, Nina.
I was thinking of Dana Hill. She was in the original Vacation, the sister, and she had something that stunted her growth, but it looks like she was just diabetic, and can diabetes stunt your growth?
Guess so.
I have no idea.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't either. She died of a paralytic stroke, I guess, but she was 32 when she passed.
Yeah.
I don't know. There is a shorty actress.
Yeah, in 1996, she went into a diabetic coma. She had a massive paralytic stroke the following month. She died at 32.
Yeah. That's it. And I have a fun fact back to Heather O'Rourke, the little girl from Poltergeist. She was the second cousin of a boy I dated in high school.
No way. That's kind of crazy.
How's that for 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon?
No doubt. So, acting was her passion, and she hoped to continue it well into her adult years. Her last two movies, Land Before Time and All Dogs Go to Heaven, under the direction of Don Bluth, solidified this fact as he was able to get the best out of Judith. Sadly, her star power during her 4 years of acting didn't make up for her life at home, as it was an absolute train wreck. Judith's success seemed to hurt her father's masculinity, and as such, it drove him to drink more, and he was already an alcoholic.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. He was also an angry drunk and would often threaten to kill his wife, Maria, Judith, and himself. In around 1985, he would fall so far into the bottle that he would end up just staying at home drunk from work, where he was supposed to be a plumber. He would also not let Maria work at all, as it was not her place. This would drive the family onto welfare for a time until Judith's career started to rise in 1986 and 1987, as she became the major breadwinner.
So it's okay for his daughter to be the breadwinner, but his wife's not allowed to go to work?
And it wasn't really.
It's also okay for him to sit on his drunk ass?
It wasn't really, because you could tell that it was hurting his masculinity because he's stupid. Like, it was driving him into his alcoholic stupor. But yeah, he's a piece of shit, so you'll find out. The winner, Joseph, would also be arrested 3 separate times for drinking and driving. Late in 1986, Maria would finally report the abuse to the police, but as still happens so often, they didn't really believe her, as there were no signs of physical abuse. Because of this, she would not press charges, and these charges could possibly have saved their lives. As Judith's career really took off, the abuse only got worse, and so did the threats of murder. When Judith took the role of Tia in Jaws, The Revenge, she would have to go to the Bahamas to film. Her father would pull a knife on her and say, "If you decide not to come back, I will cut your throat." This is according to his relatives. Yes, he would say this to a girl that had not yet hit her 9th birthday. She would return, but the rage of her father was still boiling over in the family house. She began to show signs of a mental breakdown as she began to show signs of a mental breakdown as she began to pluck her own eyelashes out, as well as her cat's whiskers.
Aww.
Like, she's just, you know, I mean, that's terrible, but she's suffering here. Like, she doesn't know what to do. She's just acting out, right?
Right.
He would throw pots, pans, and other kitchen implements at them in these outbursts, and they would end up in nosebleeds often because they would hit her in the face. Child Protective Services would be called multiple times, but nothing would end up happening. Finally, Judith would break down in front of her agent, Ruth Hansen, in May 1988, and she would be taken to see a child psychologist. The findings would be called into Child Protective Services, and they would talk to Maria. This investigation would be dropped, though, as Maria said that she would begin the process of divorcing Joseph. She had already rented an apartment in Panorama City so that she could get away from Joseph during the day. She was worried about losing the family home and all of their belongings, though, so she didn't move out immediately. Sadly, on July 28, 1988, it was reported that 3 people were found dead in a murder-suicide, and the bodies were believed to be that of Judith, Maria, and Joseph. Both Judith and Maria's bodies had been doused in gas and were lit on fire. Joseph was found in his garage where he had shot himself. A neighbor of the family stated that they thought that they had heard a gunshot around 8:30 a.m. in the morning on July 27th, so they called the police to report it. In a sad twist of fate, it would be Lance Guest, who played Judith's father in Jaws the Revenge, who would be the pallbearer at her funeral. So her fake father was the one that actually carried her at the funeral.
Yeah. Wow.
Both Judith and Maria would be buried side by side in a cemetery, Forest Lawn Memorial Park. All of Judith's toys that were not damaged in the fire would end up being donated to Goodwill. Also, her cat lived through the ordeal, and one of her friends would end up taking care of it.
Well, good.
Yeah. Sadly, her last role, All Dogs Go to Heaven, would not come out for over 1.5 years after her death. So this part here is taken from Wikipedia. In an interview with Don Bluth, the director of both Land Before Time and All Dogs Go to Heaven, praised her as being, quote, "absolutely astonishing. She understood verbal direction, even for the most sophisticated situations." Bluth stated he intended to feature her extensively in the future productions. The closing credits song, "Love Survives," was dedicated in her memory from All Dogs Go to Heaven.
Aww.
So her favorite role was Ducky in The Land Before Time in 1988. So that's back to my story. Judith had a half-brother named Barna Barsi, who would end up becoming an alcoholic and would commit suicide himself. He would jump off a bridge in Scottsdale, Arizona in 1995. I personally have to wonder if the acts of his father ended up having anything to do with his personal descent.
Oh, it must have, yeah. Right?
I mean, you got a then garbage human was probably, person.
Yeah, well, he was probably terrified that he'd end up just like his dad.
Yeah, and especially when he was falling into the alcoholic side of his father.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly.
August 23rd, 2004 would see a new grave marker added to Judith's grave. It would read, quote, "In memory of the lovely Judith Eva Barsi, 1978 to 1988, our concrete angel," yep, which is from which is from The Land Before Time, the yep. "I will leave you with one more audio clip from Judith's favorite movie, The Land Before Time."
Who are you? Huh?
My name, Petrie.
Petrie, huh? Funny name.
I flied?
No, you falled.
I fall?
You cannot fly? But how did you get way up there?
I climb.
But you are a flyer. Not a faller.
Hard things to fly.
I guess it is. We can't do it.
Nope. We cannot do that, all right.
Yeah, so that's my story. She was an adorable little actress, and it's really sad to see that she didn't get to finish her career because she really wanted to continue on as an adult.
Makes me want to watch Land Before Time.
I haven't seen it in years, but I remember it being a really, really cute cartoon. They've done all kinds of sequels, and I think there was even a TV show, but obviously she was only in the original.
Right.
But her character did live on in the sequels.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
So there was more Ducky, just wasn't her.
Yeah, but they found a way to keep it going.
Oh, good.
Yeah, so that's my story of a horrible father and the poor family.
Shall we keep rolling here?
Let's do it, yeah. So I guess the next is CJ, right?
It's me.
It's you.
And I'm pairing this case with my sparkling water beverage.
Oh, perfect.
From Sunny Select. It's got a strawberry bouquet and a nice smooth pith. Not much of a head to it.
Ah, damn it.
But it's good stuff.
Nice.
Well, unless you're a baby boomer or older, you're probably not going to recognize the name of actor Sal Mineo.
Nope.
I recognize him.
Familiar.
Doesn't it?
Bless you.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I'm not sure why it sounds familiar. Go ahead. Well, I'll figure it out.
Okay. Sounds good. I only recognize the name because when I was a kid, my mom told me that Sal Mineo was a Lebanese man. And I'm half Lebanese, so, you know, that was kind of pertinent to us. But he's not. He's from Italian descent.
Oh, God.
And if I tell you that he was one of the stars alongside actor James Dean and actress Natalie Wood in the movie Rebel Without a Cause in the 1950s, those are some of the names you might know.
I recognize all of those names, including the movie. I've never seen it, but I recognize it.
Ah, it's a classic, Mike.
That's my problem. But as far back as I go is The Crow.
Oh, Jason Lee?
Brandon Lee.
Oh, Brandon Lee. Yeah. Okay. Who's Jason? Oh, he was My Name's Earl.
Yeah. Jason Lee, I think, okay. Acts in like the movies like Clerks.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So let's go ahead and get Sal's sexual orientation out of the way. Sal was a bisexual man, and he was one of the very first in the movie industry to come out as LGBTQI. He was born a Capricorn, January 10th, 1939, in Harlem.
Oh, geez.
He grew up in the Bronx, though. As a very young kid, he was running with a tough Bronx street gang.
Wow.
So, I know, he was only 9 or 8 when he was running with these street gangs. So he was of Sicilian descent, and because of his bad tough guy behavior, he was thrown out of his Catholic school when he was 8.
Takes a lot to get kicked out of Catholic school, I think.
Does it?
Well, I mean, you can just ask for forgiveness and that's it.
Oh, that's true. Huh?
When he was 9, he was arrested for a robbery.
Ooh.
He was given the choice of spending time in juvenile correction or go into a professional acting school. And I say, what a choice, right? I mean, that's like being given the choice of taking calculus or art.
Oh, God, that reminds me of, oh, shoot, what's his name here? Is it Tim Allen or Tim? It's Tim Allen, right?
Tim Allen's a badass, yeah.
Tim Allen was arrested for, like, drug charges and ended up getting to act instead of spending a lot of time in jail, so...
We don't give kids that kind of choice anymore, do we?
No, no. Home Improvement would not happen now. Tim the Toolman Taylor.
What did he get in trouble for stealing?
Yeah, some kind of robbery. And that was probably with the gang he was involved in.
At 9.
Right.
That's pretty nuts. Yeah. 9 years old.
You know, a fun story, a fun fact of my life.
Yeah.
So... back in the days when I lived in Germany with my mom, of course, I think it was either in kindergarten or grade 1, I came home with a brand new toy. I used to walk home by myself.
Was it a battery operated toy?
Oh, dear. She was a kid. Come on now.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It was That's a toy gross. Car. Anyways, my mother asked me how I got it, and I told her I stole it. I was in kindergarten or grade 1. Anyways,
badass.
She made me go back to the store and return it.
Nice.
Yeah.
When we got back home, she made me pack up all of my toys and throw them into the dumpster.
Holy fuck.
No. She took me to the dumpster and made me throw away every single piece of toy I owned as a lesson. Guess what? Your mom did?
She was not fucking around.
No, she doesn't fuck around.
No, she's a badass.
Yeah.
So, lesson learned, don't steal. About it. Undecided.
Well, I'm impressed that you were so honest about it.
Well, I was like 6 or 7 years old. Like, where'd you get it? I was like, I got it from the store. I took it.
You badass, you.
I was an idiot, but that's fine. I learned my lesson from there. I only stole moving forward and didn't tell her about it.
So good. You learned your lesson.
You learned.
I'm just kidding. She would kill me. No.
I learned not to steal when a buddy of mine, I don't even know what year or how old we were, but he tried to steal a Playboy from a bookstore and got caught. And I walked away and never stole after that. So
I stole a pack of Trident.
Lesson yet.
What was that?
Oh, that's because you haven't stolen anything yet, right?
Just hurts.
She hasn't been caught yet.
Yeah.
Oh, that's what it is. I learned at a young age, too. I stole a pack of Trident bubble gum and had it in my top drawer. And as my mom was putting my clothes away, she asked me where I got it. And then I told her I took it, and she made me take it back to the store.
Oh.
not the chewed pieces, of course. Of just course. What was left.
I think that's great.
But she didn't come home and make me throw all the food out.
Good call.
Yeah, right?
Oh, my.
So, good old Sal, his mom decided to show him what was what. And she not only enrolled him in the professional acting classes, but she made him take dance classes, too.
Good on his mom.
Well, surprisingly, tough guy Sal, he ended up loving both. And he started to do live theater, and he excelled at it. He played a young prince in Yul Brynner's The King and I. Have you heard of that one?
Yeah.
I know of it. I've never seen it, but yeah, I definitely know of it.
Okay. His breakthrough screen role was playing gay teen John Plato Crawford, who was smitten with James Dean's character in Rebel Without a Cause. The movie is said to be cursed. We were talking about cursed movies, by the way. Oh, and that brings me back to the Heather O'Rourke, the little girl from Poltergeist. You do know that the girl who played her sister, I believe, was murdered by her boyfriend.
Yeah, I think we should do an episode about The Exorcist, which means we kind of have to stop talking about it.
A little bit.
Oh, sorry.
Although
Don't be sorry.
Looking at photos of James Dean, because I have to look back here. He was a bit of a heartthrob back then, wasn't he?
He really was. He was a handsome young man.
Yeah.
He had that bad boy
There's 100% bad boy thing going on in every photo I'm seeing.
Talking about porn, Mike, we're working over here.
What was that?
You heard me.
I'm just geeking out on James Dean here. Good looking dude.
I figured out why the name sounded familiar. When we were doing, when did we do celebrities the first time? Like forever ago. And I did Marlon Brando's son. This was the one of the cases that I was looking into. Was this one that you're doing now?
The Sal Mineo case.
Yeah, that's why it sounded familiar. Once I saw his picture, I was like, right, I remember you. But yes, please continue. Sorry.
Well, I'm glad you didn't do him so I could.
Yeah.
Yes, that's why I did it. I knew this was going to happen.
Well, it's said that that movie, Rebel Without a Cause, was cursed, and it's because James Dean died in a devastating car accident. Sal Mineo was murdered, and Natalie Wood allegedly was murdered by her husband, Robert Wagner, who's also an actor. Another tidbit from the movie, Rebel Without a Cause, the director of the movie was Nicholas Ray, and he was a self-proclaimed bisexual man also. It was rumored that he and Sal had sexual relations offset at Sal's tender age of 16.
Wow.
And it kind of makes you flashback to the good old Harvey Weinstein.
Yeah.
Before Harvey was Harvey. And maybe Kevin Spacey is a better comparison. I don't know.
It could be, yeah. Or many other famous Hollywood people.
Right. That take advantage of the young.
Yeah, unfortunately it happened, or I don't know if it still happens as often, but it happened a ton.
I isn't that where they came up with casting couch? Was back in the later days, like the late 50s and early 60s.
To me for porn?
I'm sorry?
To me for porn?
Yeah, right?
That's well, James Dean. I know the James Dean you're talking about, but there's also a famous porn actor named James Dean.
So
I
was like, oh, really?
What are you looking at? Go off that website. Bad news.
Are you telling me I should go to pornhub.com right now and look up James Dean?
Not Pornhub. You can go to X-Video. Sorry, I don't know.
X-Hamster?
Mike knows them all.
Yeah, I do too.
I wasn't going to admit it, but I do too. Yeah. World. Anyways.
We're adults.
Well, some of us.
That's true.
Well, the last little tidbit for the movie Rebel Without a Cause, Sal was nominated for an Academy Award as Best Supporting Actor for the role. And he also briefly dated Natalie Wood. By now, Sal was living in Hollywood, but I'm not sure if it was the whole family that moved out to Hollywood or just Sal and the rest of them stayed in the Bronx. But if he was only, you know, a young teenager, I would think somebody came out to Southern California with him. But it's also listed that Sal's siblings were actors, so I kind of assumed that the whole family came out. Not that way. Came out.
I see what you did there.
Yeah, so did I.
Sal had booked and filmed two other movies that same year that he made Rebel Without a Cause in 1955. The following year, Sal booked and filmed three more movies. This kid was raking in the money. And he pretty much picked up steady work for the rest of that decade. He also had a recording artist career. And he had a couple of top 40 hits, including Lasting Love and Start Moving. And I had never heard of either of these, but it was kind of the thing for actors back then, if they were kind of cute and baby-faced, to start recording careers as well as their acting careers.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. You saw that all the time.
Yeah. Like Marky Mark.
Like Marky Mark. I like Marky Mark.
Me too.
We know, here? Nina, we know.
Also a criminal past.
Yes.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I guess I didn't know that. He earned another Academy Award nomination in the early 60s for the movie Exodus. And during filming of Exodus, he met a 15-year-old English-born actress, and her name was Jill Haworth. they had an on-again, off-again kind of relationship. And Sal was the one who popped her cherry, actually.
Oh.
But
I'm just going to vomit here.
You hate that? Yeah. Is that a bad
phrase? The worst. Yeah.
Sal and Jill, they really did seem to love each other. And they were even engaged to be married for a little bit. In 1965, he starred as a stalker in a low-budget thriller called Who Killed Teddy Bear? And I actually watched this movie. It was kind of creepy.
Who killed Teddy Bear? That poor teddy bear.
Right?
The washing machine did it.
It was the dryer. God. Come on.
Yeah.
Fair. It was Nina with the candle bra in the study.
So during the 50s, he was really, he got a lot of popularity. But towards the end of the 50s and early 60s, Sal started to lose his boyish good looks. So he is being cast as crazy psychotic murderers now.
That's
and
fun.
Probably because he was open about his bisexuality, his acting career started to taper off in the mid-60s.
That seems like a weird time for that to be a problem.
Right?
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The time of the hippies and free love and stuff like that. It's
supposed to be the sexual revolution. Why are you being such a crazy prude?
Hippies usually weren't the ones that are green-lighting movies, though.
Hollywood was pretty homophobic back at that time.
Yeah.
And even with California being known as an extremely liberal state, homosexuality and bisexuality, it didn't even become legalized in California until 1976.
That seems late to me. I don't know what it was here.
It seems late to you? Or
well, for such a liberal state, yeah, but...
Yeah, it should have been.
Do you know back when
60s.
It was legalized here, do you, by any chance?
I'm looking it up.
Oh, good, because I don't have access to my phone at the moment.
And because I'm not part of the community, I don't know it off the top of my head, so...
June 27th, 1969.
69.
Oh, see? Yeah.
So it's wow. Not really that much further ahead, but...
Well, about 7 years. That's not bad.
It's not bad, but it's still not early enough. Damn it.
At least it happened.
But gay marriage wasn't legal until 2005.
It's true.
Well, Sal started to become a struggling artist. He was able to land a few parts here and there, a couple of parts in movies or on a television series like Columbo or something. But his debt started to pile up, and there's Hollywood stories told that Sal actually camped out on the famous producer Francis Ford Coppola's front yard because he was trying to grab a role in the movie The Godfather.
Holy shit.
Wow.
He didn't get it.
That was a good movie, though.
Yeah, but he didn't get any role, and I don't know if that hurt his chances more. It might have. He dabbled.
I think it would.
I think it would hurt his chances.
So, has everyone seen The Godfather?
I have a long time ago, and I think the only part that really stands out is that damn bloody horse head in the bed.
Oh, I love the scene where the car pulls up to that, it's like a toll booth, and then they just open up with the Tommy guns. Mm-hmm.
Do you think The Godfather, the second movie, was better than the first?
Never seen the second one.
I haven't either.
Well, you guys suck.
we're waiting for you.
Usually when they have like a part two or a sequel, it's not as good. The second Godfather movie, I am telling you guys, if you enjoyed the first one, you have to fucking watch it.
Okay, I'll fucking watch it.
I'm in.
Me too.
It's very, very seldomly do I think that like a second one, obviously the first Godfather is a fucking classic and beautiful.
Right.
The second one is just...
Even better.
It's great.
Well, the second Star Wars movie is better, so hey, whatever.
All right, I'll have to check that out.
And Toy Story.
That's no. True.
It can happen. It can happen. But Aladdin 2, Lion King 2, all those are terrible.
Absolutely.
Toy Story 2 was the best. But that's because they had Jessie, and I like Jessie.
Oh, okay. That makes sense. Totally makes sense.
So okay. Sal started to direct plays that he'd also star in. And in 1970, he met and fell in love with and started a long-term relationship with a male actor named Courtney Burr. In 1971, Sal started to give up on film and television altogether. he went back to the whole theater and producing, and he went on to star in a gay-themed play called Fortune in Men's Eyes. And guess who was in it with him?
I have no idea.
James Dean.
No way. Wow.
No, he was dead. I believe he was gone by then.
Britney Spears.
No, it was a man. It was a very, very young Don Johnson from Miami Vice fame.
No fucking way.
Yeah, there was wow. Even rumors going around that Don Johnson might have been gay, but I don't think he was.
I don't think he's gay, but he might be bi, because I've seen him with too many women, so I don't know.
Yeah, and popping out all those kids.
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, I don't think he popped out any kids.
Well, that's true, yeah.
Oh, well, I guess you wouldn't. That would really hurt.
Although there are so many, what's the proper term? Because it's beard for women, isn't it? But, like, there's so many beards for people, so.
It's still the same.
Is it?
Okay. It's still a beard, yeah.
So there's so many of me, the beard, for a lot of people out there.
Moving on.
Well, things, after a few years, really petered out for Sal's career. And then he landed a role as a bisexual burglar in the stage comedy P.S. Your Cat Is Dead.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
That's the worst name.
I hate cats, but that poor cat.
I'm telling you. He was also slated to direct a new movie for MGM. So things were really starting to look up for Sal during the late part of 1975. But then the following year, on February 12th, 1976, a now 37-year-old Sal, he was arriving home after his play rehearsal from P.S. Your Cat Is Dead, and he parked his 76 Duster in the carport of his apartment complex. He got out, and he started to walk to his apartment through an alleyway. He saw a man approaching him with a knife, and he screamed, "Oh my God, help! Help me, please." He was jumped and stabbed directly in his heart with a knife. The neighbors heard Sal's scream, and they heard footsteps running away. The neighbors went downstairs in the alley to see if they could help Sal, and the police were called. Sal was pronounced dead on the scene. He had $21 in his pocket, and he still had his car keys. And there were two eyewitness neighbors that described the killer as a white man with long brown hair. They said he was about 5'10 with a slender build. Police went upstairs to investigate Sal's apartment, and they found gay men magazines and leather pants. So immediately they determined Sal's death was a hate crime.
Of course.
They ruled out a robbery because he still had his money and his keys on him. But a gay hate crime, really? I think at least, or I hope that at least law enforcement these days investigate a little more before making a determination like that. The case went cold for 2 years, and then in a prison in Michigan, a 23-year-old black inmate named Lionel Williams was bragging to another inmate that he said that he killed Sal Mineo, and then later he said he made it up. Lionel was serving time for writing bad checks in Michigan. Backing up the murder story was Lionel's wife in Los Angeles. She said that the night that Sal Mineo was killed, her husband came home drenched in blood. Lionel was a pizza delivery guy at the time, and he'd been committing nonviolent robberies in the area that Sal lived. He was convicted, and he was given a 51-year-to-life sentence.
Damn.
Which it just surprises me, because the witnesses even said it was a white man with long blonde hair or long brown hair.
Yeah.
Lionel was out on probation in the late 90s. Then he was back in and back out of prison for some more robberies. Does it ever seem to anyone else the police like to hurry through these cases just so they can close it, whether it's correct or not?
Never.
Sometimes, definitely.
Never. Yeah, always.
Well, I don't know what happens.
Not always. Don't be a shit.
Sometimes they do an okay job, but sometimes
too often.
So many cases that I've been reading on, they just want to hurry up and get it over.
I'm almost done watching the Innocence Project documentary that's on Netflix.
Yeah.
I still have 3 episodes left, but oh my God.
Were they all innocent?
They zeroed in on who they thought was a suspect, and without really going, even though he had a full fucking alibi by many, many people, nope, that's our guy. So, yeah.
They have a little bit of circumstantial evidence. Like maybe somebody was nearby at the time, so they must be the killer. What happened to hard evidence? I don't know. I just don't understand it. So Lionel Williams is a black man and had a black afro back then. But one of the articles I read said police were able to find a picture of Lionel with his hair dyed brown and it was straightened. So that's why they thought it was Lionel, I guess.
Yeah.
It doesn't change the color of his skin.
Yeah.
I don't know.
No, it doesn't.
And, you know, I've seen pictures of Lionel and he's very black man. Oh, well. The medical examiner made a cast of Sal's knife wounds and Lionel's wife said, yeah, that's from his knife. So it sounded like Lionel had done his wife wrong and she started saying things to the police that the police wanted to hear to close the case. But is it all fabricated? Why didn't she just come forward the night Sal was killed if Lionel came home soaked in blood? I don't know. I don't have the answer. But it does sound like it was kind of a setup to me in lazy police work. Lionel's a burglar. He's a robber and he's a thief. But a murderer? I don't know, guys. Inmates brag all the time about shit just so they sound like badasses. And I know he served some time for it. He was also released, but I'm not sure he's the real killer. And since Sal's money and keys were still on him, I don't think Sal was the victim of a robbery either. But I have to leave it there because there's really nothing else to go on. The physical evidence was pretty much ruined at the crime scene.
Yeah.
Because the neighbors were trying to be helpful. They were touching Sal and stepping all over the blood around his body. The police think they have their man with Lionel Williams. So, case closed, but I have my doubts. And that's about it, guys.
That's quite the story. Wow.
Kind of sad if they have the wrong man.
Oh, it's absolutely fucking horrible if they have the wrong man.
Yeah, but how do you go to prove or disprove anything when the crime scene is mangled, right?
Yeah, it's fucked.
Right.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah, it's awful when a crime scene is not locked up right away and it can be contaminated with all kinds of people.
Yeah.
CJ, what year did this happen again?
1976.
Yeah, so DNA evidence then still wasn't really a thing, right? So I don't know that they knew to... Obviously, you have to preserve a crime scene, but maybe they didn't necessarily understand the importance of collecting such evidence or whatever.
Yeah, or just the level of containment that you'd have today.
Well, I imagine the neighbors had a lot of adrenaline going, and they thought they might be able to save him. And that's why they were, you know, right there touching him and trying to stop blood or whatever and contaminating, unfortunately, the crime scene.
Well, in their defense, too, any police officer, ambulance attendant, firefighter, if they have a feeling, first responder in general, if they think the person might still be alive, who gives a fuck about any of the evidence? It's rescue this person first.
Yeah.
And then hopefully the evidence is preserved. If they know the person's dead, different story. Then you go to preserving evidence and all that stuff. But if even the person's alive, you don't give a fuck about anything. It's save their life first. It's always that first.
That's true.
And it should be. I mean, because if they live, they will tell you what happened. They'll tell you the evidence.
The crime won't be so bad.
Yeah. But unfortunately, you rush in thinking they might still be alive. You destroy the evidence and they're dead. Then, you know, it's hard to respond to that afterwards. But what can you do? It's quite the story, though.
Mm-hmm. So the story I'm doing today is called Pot, Porno, and Pee Wee Herman. criminal wow. or eccentric?
Yes.
And the beer that I got for this one is called Vibrant Things, and it's from Steel and Oak Brewing Company. And Mike and I got together while being
socially distance
apart from each other, and there was sanitation of the beer cans and a safe handoff.
Yes, I had a spray bottle of rubbing alcohol to make sure this was safe.
Which was nice. We got to have a little visit.
Yeah, it's good to be able to safely visit friends from a distance, because fuck, this social distancing thing is so tough for me. Mm-hmm. So yeah, this is Vibrant Things from Steel and Oak, which I may be in Burnaby, but it is definitely the closest brewery to my house, which is in New Westminster. It's a tropical pale ale. It is 4.6% alcohol. It is a beautiful beer. It's definitely murky. It looks like orange juice with a white head on top. Beautiful looking beer.
Sounds good.
It smells like tropical fruit, a little bit of orange juice. It's just kind of sweet. A little bit of tartness that you get from that fruit. It's basically what you expect from sort of a tropically citrus fruit. And on the flavor, it's not much different. It's kind of like pineapple juice, a little bit of orange juice, maybe some mango, all kind of blended together with like a hint of grain. But it's sparkly. Yeah, it's a great beer. And I'll just say here, because it's worth mentioning here, support your local breweries wherever they are. If it's in California, like UCGA, if it's here in BC, a lot of breweries are doing home deliveries now. Go to their website and check it out. It can be home delivery in your local area. It could be for the entire state or province. It could be for the whole country. Who knows, depending on what it is. But support your local business, whatever it is, because we have to pull through this bullshit of the COVID-19. And make sure that your small business survives this, because they need help. We all do.
Went to the ice cream store, Mike.
Nice.
Yeah.
So depending on, like, it might be your brewery. It might be whatever. Like, maybe your, like, local farmer's market, whatever it is. But go support them, because we got to pull through all this shit. And we want to make sure that our local independent small businesses survive.
Word.
Well, let's get into the last story for this episode.
Paul Rubens, born Rubenfeld, was born August 27th, 1952 in Peekskill, New York, to parents Judy and Milton Rubenfeld. He was raised in Sarasota, Florida, where his parents owned a lamp store. Quick side note, Sarasota was once the winter home of the Ringling Brothers Circus.
Oh, wow. Isn't
that weird? Can you imagine, like, as soon as the season changes to winter, and then all of a sudden, bunch of circus people?
Like, not a big surprise, really.
Well, circus people and probably retirees, because that's when everyone leaves Canada anyway.
True.
Paul's mother was a teacher, and his father was a car salesperson who previously flew for Britain's Royal Air Force, the U.S. Ooh. Army Air Forces in World War II, and was one of the founding pilots of the Israeli Air Force during the 1948 Arab-Israeli War.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
He's got some ties.
Yeah, it's crazy. Paul has one younger brother and one younger sister. Paul joined the Los Angeles troupe, the Groundlings, in the 1970s and started his career as an improv comedian and stage actor. He remained with them for 6 years. In 1982, he became the star in a stage show about a character that he had been working on for years. It ran for 5 sold-out months at the Roxy Theater, and HBO made a special about it. This character was Pee Wee Herman, and it was an instant cult hit. For the next decade, Paul committed to his character completely. He did all public appearances as Pee Wee, and by 1985, he was working with Warner Brothers to release the feature film Pee Wee's Big Adventure. Have you guys seen this? Did you guys watch this?
I saw, like, everything that Pee-wee put out. Yeah. Pee-wee was huge as a child.
And you can't say his name without the song Tequila going through my head.
Yeah.
Tequila.
Exactly. So the film had a $6 to $7 million budget and was directed by Tim Burton.
No way.
Yeah, he was like an unknown at the time.
Basically. Was Helena Bonham Carter in it?
No, this is well. This is before then.
Before the wedding and before the divorce, huh? Okay.
Yeah. So the movie made just under $41 million.
Wow.
So considering that they'd spent less than $7 million on it, that's huge.
Huge success, yeah.
Yeah. The sequel, Big Top PB, was released 3 years later in 1988. They'd spent $20 million on it, and it only made $15
million. Whoopsie!
Oh, wow. That's a huge loss.
Good thing for him, though, he'd already signed a TV deal with CBS in 1986 while he was still, like, riding the fame of the first movie.
Wait, did it start as a movie series and then go to TV? I thought it was TV first.
No, it went from the from being an improv character to a stage show, then the movie, and then it was a TV show.
My bad. I definitely didn't know my own childhood.
So Paul directed, produced, and starred as Pee-wee in the Saturday morning kids show, Pee-wee's Playhouse. That was from September 13th, 1986 to November 10th, 1990. So the TV show is my clearest memory of Pee-wee as a character. Clearly yours too, Mike.
Yeah, boy, yeah.
My siblings and I loved this show when we were kids.
Loved it.
So that's actually Cyndi Lauper singing the opening credits.
What?
I didn't know that.
Cyndi Lauper? No way.
They were friends. They were friends. So she did the opening credits for the show.
Holy fuck.
And the gadgets on the show are completely irresistible.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
So Paul also did voice work in films during this time. In 1986, he was the voice of the ship's computer in Flight of the Navigator, which was a movie that I thought only my siblings and I remembered, but apparently other people. Did you guys see that one?
No, never.
No.
I have.
Okay. So
that's a good movie.
50%.
Yeah. He also did cameos, including a visit to Sesame Street, which is pretty much, you know, how you know you're famous.
Yeah, for sure. Back then,
kids especially. Entertainer. If you make it to Sesame Street, then that solidifies it. So Paul was very careful with what became associated with Pee-wee Herman. So, for example, he was a very heavy smoker at the time, but would never be photographed while dressed as Pee-wee and smoking. So if they were filming and he was in character, then he just wouldn't, because he didn't want Pee-wee associated with anything bad, because he knew kids were watching. You know what I mean?
That's a good method actor or a character actor. You don't want to give away the fact that you're not a perfect person.
Yeah. Well, he also never endorsed like junk food. Like Pee-wee, the character, never endorsed any junk food. And he tried to release a sugar-free cereal, but the very unfortunate name was Ralston Purina Pee-wee Chow cereal. So
sounds like dog food. Wow. So it didn't,
my gosh.
Yeah, that didn't pan out.
No.
But terrible. Pee-wee merchandise.
It sounds like a fucking animal's food.
Yeah. Pee-wee merchandise in general peaked in 1988, making over $25 million.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. And he'd earned a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame by 1989.
Wow. That's amazing.
When the show ended in 1990, Paul decided to take a break from Pee-wee as a character. And you can't blame him, because he'd been essentially living as Pee-wee for the last 8 years of his life. After 45 episodes and one Christmas special, the show had earned 15 Emmy Awards.
Wow.
Which is like, that's an extremely high rate of success.
It really is, yeah.
in July of 1991, Paul had moved back to Florida where his family was, which, I mean, it's Florida, so uh-oh. And it was in the lovely city of Sarasota that Paul was arrested for indecent exposure.
And he wasn't dressed like Pee-wee, right?
No. He was as himself. His mugshot will actually be available on the website, and it's not good.
No, it's not.
indecent exposure, bad, obviously. But the thing is that the details are that he was in an adult movie theater masturbating.
Yeah, he was in a theater of a bunch of people that were probably masturbating.
Yeah.
Okay, first of all, I go to movies all the times, and exactly zero times have other people masturbated.
But this is adult theater.
This is a theater where adults go and they're playing porn.
Yeah, they play porn at these
on
theaters.
The big screen.
Oh, yeah, I haven't been to one of those.
Because they don't have a lot of these theaters.
Wasn't there one in New West, but it got shut down like
no,
a couple years ago?
The one in New West is actually an adult, it is a strip club. But they don't have an alcohol license, so you have to drink pop for like $9 a glass.
The Paramount,
yeah. So it's still there, and you can still go watch strippers there, but you can't drink alcohol.
Hey,
so
sorry.
I can't watch a stripper there because I need alcohol.
I'm just going to go back there. Who the fuck pays movie prices to go watch porn?
These people like sure P.B. Herman.
I'm sure it's...
Okay, so the only reason people watch porn is to get off.
Of course.
Obviously, if you put it in a theater, I feel like that's sending mixed messages. What do you expect me just to sit here fucking soaking wet? No.
Wow.
Like, you can walk up with blue balls and expect, like, oh, when I get home, I'll take care of it myself. No, obviously, you're going to sit there and fucking yank one out. I mean, I feel like... Okay, but hear me out though, right? Like, what do you?
No, yeah, this is that's my point, yeah. Right?
What do you expect to happen? No, let's just put a bunch of horny men and women into the situation.
Mostly men,
and then frown upon it when they do. Like, you know, did he come on the back of someone's head? Probably not, right? But like,
yeah, it is pretty fucked up. But it's an adult theater. What do you expect? This is not a VIP like. 19 plus regular movies, but you can drink alcohol. This was a porn theater.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's the thing. It's just like, okay, so you go to, I don't know many people that just watch porn because they have nothing better to do and that aren't like using.
Like it's not something that's on in the background while you're vacuuming, you know?
Well, it depends who you are. Come on now.
I guess.
You watch it for like a purpose, right? Like for a self, whatever, which is fine. Porn's great. Like, do your thing, right? Like, why the fuck would you ever go to a theater? Anyways, I have nothing positive to say about this topic.
Well, I mean, nowadays with X Hamster and Pornhub and whatever, you don't need to go to those theaters anymore. But there wasn't always those options back in the day.
No, this was in 1991.
But do you also think that maybe it was the thrill of being in public?
Yes.
Oh, probably. Yeah, it was definitely a voyeurism thing, I'm sure.
Yeah.
I don't know. But that's just like, I don't know. It's like having a fake injection site and then telling someone doing drugs is bad. It's just like, okay, yeah. Here's a place you can come and do it. And then you do it and it's just like, oh my God, but you did them. It's like.
But you did pot here, not heroin. Like, fuck off.
No one can see me do this. What do you think I'm going to do?
Yeah.
Fucking work on a Nobel Prize winning piece? No, I'm gonna fucking rip one out. It's fine.
So the police had actually been watching the audience while the movie was playing.
Yeah, that's fucking weird. That's like strange voyeurism there.
Well, then, right? And they made note of who was being like indecent.
What?
And then when people were leaving, they just arrested them. So he wasn't even the only one.
Okay,
there was three other guys that got arrested too.
That's seriously fucked up at that point. This is a fucking adult theater. Gross, yes. Whacking off in the theater, totally gross. But
could
fuck
you
off.
Anyone in the staff there who has to clean up the seats be like, oh, is this gum or semen?
That'd be the worst job ever.
It would be, but do you really arrest people for this shit if it's that kind of theater? Like, what the fuck?
So, yeah, what are the cops doing with the video? I bet you the cops are sitting there and you have that one sick cop in the bunch who's just like, oh, yeah, there's another one.
Bust another nut.
You laugh, but y'all know I'm fucking probably right.
Probably right, yeah.
Anyways, also, so what, just because he was the one famous person who got caught jerking it, everyone is talking about it, but I don't know.
Well, so when he was arrested, he did confirm that he was Pee Wee Herman, and he offered to do a charity event for the local sheriff's office if they would keep it quiet, which they agreed to. But while being released, he was recognized by a reporter from Sarasota Herald Tribune, and he tried to make the same deal with him, but by then the word was out. Clearly somebody leaked it, you know what I mean?
Right.
And if the sheriff's office agreed to this deal, Somebody said something, you know?
But like, okay, do you guys think what he did was actually bad?
I don't.
I don't either.
You know what?
Right?
I used to think it was bad because I hadn't heard the whole story, but now hearing it, no, I don't.
Yeah.
I thought it was actually a regular theater.
But you don't hear that part. You just hear that he was, like, that it was indecent exposure.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, he didn't fucking go see Land Before Time in theaters and jerk it off to the dining dinosaur. Like, he was an adult fucking Well, okay, but hear me out though, right? Like, it's different circumstances. He's not watching whatever, right? Like, you're in an adult movie theater, it's adult scenes, there's, what you said, three other people along him, so four people that got arrested, but he's the only one that matters, let's say matter, air quotes, because he's a famous person, but like, anyways.
I thought he was going to see Top Gun here and whacking it off. If he was in a regular theater, then yeah, it's not great, because you probably have children in the theater, you probably, you know, there's people that shouldn't see that shit. If you're in a porn theater, like, fuck, you're in a porn theater.
Yeah, and I highly doubt there's a guy sitting next to him also jerking it off, like, in unison. Like, come on.
There's probably every seat full and everyone's jerking it. It's just, it's a different time. It's a porn theater.
Everyone is jerking it, but some people are definitely going home with, like, a change of underwear. Like,
yeah. Oh, yeah. CJ, you're probably right. There probably was other people jerking each other.
Anyways, I don't think what he did is that bad, and to like castrate him for it, but it's just interesting the way the media will spin a story.
Yeah,
definitely.
They only share the salacious material, right?
Of course, yeah.
I think that's probably because he was a performer for children.
I agree there. Yeah,
he's a grown ass man. What do you expect him to do with his like dying babies inside him? Keep him there forever?
Oh my!
Well, am I wrong?
Yeah. No, but yes.
I'm not wrong. Like, just because you're a child, I don't know. Anyways, let's not get into it.
Yeah. So on November 7th, 1991, he pled no contest. This meant that the charge was left off of Paul's record. More information on that shortly. And in exchange, he made and paid for two anti-drug PSAs. The links for these are on the website. Both were later praised for showing kids that drugs are bad in a way that they could easily understand, but he wasn't talking down to them, which was part of his whole thing, was that he taught kids, but he never talked down to them. Unfortunately for Paul, the word was already out, and thanks to the national media, many people had already made their decision about what kind of person Paul was, and therefore how wholesome Pee Wee as a kid's entertainer was. Many people, such as Cindy Lauper, Annette Funicello, Zsa Zsa Gabor, and Bill Cosby, came to his defense. I doubt that anyone wants that deceitful pig Bill Cosby on their side these days, but at the time it was a good thing. The largest amount of support came from his fans. Remember the show A Current Affair? Do you guys remember that show?
I do.
Yeah, so they received tens of thousands of calls for a telephone survey, because that was a thing then. And the callers supported Paul in a 9-to-1 ratio. You guys remember when shows did that? Where they'd post a survey on their just like on the screen, on the TV, and you could call in and press like press one if this is your opinion, press two if this is your opinion, you know, before social media was a thing.
It sounds familiar, but not really.
I only remember that like on the singing shows.
Oh, you know, yeah, when you were voting?
Yeah.
Yeah.
American Idol, like the first few seasons, right?
American Idol. Yeah. That's the one.
Yeah. I remember a show that was like a choose your own adventure, but you called in and whoever, like whichever next step got the most calls, then that would be the next part of the story they played.
Interesting.
I forget what it was called, though. Doesn't matter. So this indecent exposure arrest wasn't actually Paul's first arrest. He'd been arrested for loitering near an adult theater in the same county 20 years earlier.
The horror.
Yeah. I don't. How much time are you spending outside of the theater that it's enough time to get arrested for loitering?
That is true, but still, what the fuck?
It's weird.
At least you know he had a heavy sperm count.
I mean, he's a human. He's an adult. Porn.
But what's the point of loitering outside, though?
It was way before he was famous, so it's not like he was worried someone would see him there.
Was he too young to go in?
I'd have to assume.
Not in 1971. I forget what year I said he was born.
Like 54? 52?
Yeah, 52, so he was 19.
Hmm.
Anyway, in 1983, he received 2 years of probation for possession of marijuana. But it's like, who cares, right? Just pot.
Especially now.
Yeah.
You can go to a BC cannabis store now, which is run by the BC government.
The 1991 nonsense seemed to derail Paul's career for years, but he was really still busy with small parts in some really great movies. In 1992, he was the Penguin's father in Batman Returns.
No way. And, wow.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. In 1996, he played an FBI agent in Matilda. You guys know that movie, right?
No.
Uh-uh.
It's a great movie. I mean, it's a great book, and the movie is also good. Anyway, I was obsessed with the book when I was a kid. He also did a lot of voice work during this time. In 1993, he played Locke in Nightmare Before Christmas.
Ooh.
And I've seen this movie like at least twice a year since it came out.
Yeah.
Is that one of the kids, the trick-or-treaters?
Yeah. There's okay. Locke, Shock, and Barrel.
Oh, that's what it was. Okay. Yeah.
Which one was Locke? The devil?
Locke, he's the skeleton.
The skeleton, right? Okay.
Now you got me doubting myself here.
Ah!
I typed in Locke, Shock, and Barrel, and it's like tattoos, tattoo, tattoo, tattoo. So apparently it's a very common tattoo. No, Locke is the devil one.
Okay.
I feel horrible.
They were the Boogie Boys. It's okay.
Pardon?
They were the Boogie Boys.
Yeah. So Paul didn't have another large part in a big budget project until 1999. And he then appeared in Mystery Men and Blow. I didn't see Blow. Did you guys? I don't know.
Blow?
Yeah.
I think I did.
Johnny Depp and Penelope Cruz. Yes.
Yeah. So I didn't see that. And I was underwhelmed by Mystery Men. Did anyone see that?
I don't remember.
There were so many good people in it. That's what I didn't understand. Like Janine Garofalo, Hank Azaria, Ben Stiller, William H. Macy. And it just wasn't good.
Doesn't always work, yeah.
But when he was promoting these movies, he was finally appearing as himself in all the interviews. So that must have at least been a nice change for him to not have to be in character. Especially with that voice. Like, oh my God. Like with Pee-wee's voice. In November 2002, police served a search warrant on Paul's home. At the time, Paul was on set for Elton John's music video, This Train Don't Stop There Anymore, which is such a good video. Police found two grainy videotapes and dozens of photographs. The city attorney described this as a collection of child pornography. Paul and his lawyer described it as Rob Lowe's sex videotape. Yes, that Rob Lowe.
Oh, geez.
Paul had Rob Lowe's sex videotape.
Wow.
Which I didn't even, I had never heard about, but apparently that was a thing that happened.
Hmm.
Yeah. And when I was looking into it, Rob Lowe actually, when this got released, he actually cites that point as something really good that happened to him. Because it shouldn't have been released, you know, but it is this thing that happened in his life that helped him get sober.
Wow.
So it changed his life when it came out. So that's good. They also found a collection of 30 to 100-year-old photos. Paul was a collector of erotica, including films, muscle magazines, and a sizable collection of mostly homosexual vintage erotica. He often purchased in bulk, and according to one of his magazine dealers, there was no way he could have known what was on every page of every magazine that he'd ever bought. The DA looked at the collection and examined Paul's computer and found no grounds for bringing felony charges. The city attorney, however, brought misdemeanor charges on the last day that it was legally allowed to bring charges.
That's lame.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It makes you wonder, like, why did he wait so long? Was he, like, unsure of that he should do it? Or, I don't know. What's the point of waiting? Paul pled not guilty in December and spent the next 2 years in Florida caring for his terminally ill father, who died in February of 2004 of cancer. The charges were eventually dropped in March 2004, but Paul had to agree to plead to a lesser charge. And for the next 3 years, he had to register his address with the sheriff's office and couldn't be in the company of minors without permission from a parent or legal guardian.
What the fuck?
So the reason that they had initially searched his home was because his name came up when they arrested Jeffrey Jones
and searched
his house. And wow. They came up because they were both photography collectors. So then they searched Paul's home as well.
But Paul didn't have any child porn, correct?
Well, there was like some of the photographs from the really old pictures.
The vintage stuff?
Yeah. They said that it could be kids, like it could be teenagers in the photos, but
gosh.
He hadn't even seen some of the photos. So it was just, and there was nothing on his computer.
Hmm.
So it was, that's why the DA didn't press charges, but then the city attorney was a bit of a zealot.
Mm.
So he did. Starting in 2006, Paul started doing cameo and guest appearances in many projects. I remember seeing him in 30 Rock as this like ridiculously inbred prince who's the love interest for Jane Krakowski's character, Jenna. I don't know if you guys ever watched that show, but it was truly horrible and hilarious. Like, he has like hands that are like the size of your thumb because he's so inbred.
God.
Because yeah, he's like from whatever, it doesn't matter.
The hills have eyes.
Oh, yeah.
That kind of character?
Yeah. That same year, the Cartoon Network aired the show's 45 original episode nightly on Adult Swim lineup. And it attracted 1.5 million viewers a night. In 2007, TV Guide named the show one of the top 10 TV cult classics of all time. So Pee-wee's small Glenn plaid suits were ridiculous at the time the show was released. You guys know what he looks like, right?
Yeah.
But as it turns out, he was just ahead of his time because by the late 90s, designers started creating tightly cut suits with the high armholes and the short trousers that are just like his, which I hate. Like, I went to get a suit and they're trying to do the cut of the leg and it's so short and I'm like, I don't like that. I don't think it looks good, but
what the hell do I really know
about fashion, right?
More than me, probably.
Yeah.
Just a little bit more.
Just a little bit, but a little bit more.
Paul announced the relaunch of Pee-wee's career in August of 2009, and the stage show originally scheduled for November 8th to 29th at the Music Box Theater had to be switched to January 12th, 2010 to February 17th and they moved it to a theater that was twice the size because they sold out so fast. They had to add extra dates in a theater twice the size.
Wow.
Just crazy. Like so many years later, and there's still so many people interested. In February 2015, Netflix acquired the rights to produce a new Pee-wee film. Pee-wee's Big Holiday was released on March 18th. And we watched it with our daughter a few weeks ago now, and it was pretty great, actually. It was funny to see him again, and she friggin' loved it. She'd never seen Pee-wee before, so she thought it was hysterical.
I'm looking it up right now.
It's pretty good. Yeah. And at some point, he stopped aging because he looks the same. I mean, I get that there's makeup and everything, but it was shocking because he's like in his 60s.
What was it called again?
It's Pee-wee's Big Holiday.
All right, because there's Pee-wee's Big Holiday Playhouse and Pee-wee's Playhouse Christmas Special.
Well, that's the shows you would have seen when you were a kid, though, Mike. So I don't know if you want to watch that too.
Well, I'm just looking it up on Netflix right now.
Yeah.
And saving it.
So yeah, in my opinion, Paul Rubens is an oddball for sure, but not a criminal.
Right, and that was his brand, to be an oddball.
Yeah, definitely. Sure.
If you ever liked the original show, then I suggest you check out the movie. And if you never saw it, go check it out. The show is on Netflix as well, like Mike was just saying. And if you have kids, get them to check it out because it's good stuff.
And they have nothing better to fucking do right now anyways.
Yeah, that's a good point. But nobody teaches kids about like important things without talking down to them. And that's
nice. That does matter, yeah.
It's a good balance of being like kitschy, goofiness, and education. Okay. And ridiculous, which kids love ridiculous, right?
Oh, I fuck, love they do.
Oh, yeah. I don't know what you think. And maybe something else will happen that'll prove me wrong in thinking that he's a oddball and not a criminal, but I hope not, you know?
Nina, why don't you play the sound clip again there for Pee-wee?
So now that I said it, you're like, obviously that's Cyndi Lauper, right?
No.
No? Who else sings like that? Betty Boop, maybe, but I don't think
I would have guessed Betty Boop first, actually, because I don't really know Cyndi Lauper at all.
Anyway.
I know her name. All right.
And I just wanted to thank you guys so much for letting me be part of your show today, too.
Thank you for being part of our show. Why don't you give a little shout out to what your show is and a little bit more of a background of your show.
Okay. My show is Beyond the Rainbow, True Crimes of the LGBT Community. And I'm just too lazy to do the Q and I also in the name.
You're also not great at acronyms, right?
Huh?
You're not great at acronyms either, so.
No, I suck at acronyms. You know that.
I do.
Basically, it's a true crime show featuring crimes about the members of the LGBT, crimes either committed against or by LGBTQI community members. And it's a lot of fun for me to do the podcast, but not necessarily to have to tell about the stories because some of them are just horrid.
Oh, yeah, no. I mean, it's just like our show. Most of the stories are terrible, but it's nice to be able to share the story and spread the word and
Give victims a voice. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah.
But I know I always say, I hope you enjoyed the show. And I just, feels do you really sometimes enjoy listening about murder? Well, yeah, I guess I do. but there are some terrible, terrible crimes out there.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
I'm a one-woman show, so this was really weird for me to have other people on the other end.
There was a man on your show. What the fuck? No.
Oh, no, not one of those.
Exactly. So shout out to our Patreon supporters. You can go to patreon.com/brewcrime.
And thank you, Nina's mom, because I know that you contribute.
Exactly. Yay, my mom.
So shout out to our Patreon supporters, Three Beers In Podcast, Amber, Ange, Daniela, Nina's mom, the Faves of Our Lives podcast, and True Crime Nana. You can find us at brewcrime.com, and that's where you get all our sources. You can go to our store at brewcrime.threadless.com. You can also send us an email if you want to connect with us. You can go to brewcrime@pacificbeerchat.com. And thanks for listening. Cheers.
Cheers.
Bye.
Bye.
Brewcrime's intro was created by Mike using Creative Commons Attribution Licensed Audio from purple-planet.com, soundbible.com, and freesoundeffects.com. Logo design was by Ben Greenberg. All cases and stories were written by Beck, Nina, and Mike, and our sources are put into the show notes for each episode. We always want to give credit to the people that research the cases we talk about. Check out our store at brewcrime.threadless.com, where you can purchase swag like t-shirts, phone cases, beach towels, and all kinds of cool stuff. We can also be found on your favorite podcast apps, our hosts, Spreaker.com or brewcrime.com, as well as at Brewcrime on Twitter, at Brewcrime on Facebook, at facebook.com/groups/brewcrime. Thanks for listening. This has been a production of Pacific Beer Chat.
Hi, everyone. This is Clint.
This is Ross.
This is Joel.
This is Cutter.
This is Tony.
From Three Beers In.
A proud member of Big Heads Media Network.
Each episode we review local Austin craft beer and talk about
Clove and Bananas.
References I don't get.
And Academy Award winner Matthew McConaughey.
So tune in,
crack open a beer,
and hang out with us.
Find us on bigheadsmedia.com,
iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, TuneIn, Spotify,
or on threebeersinpodcast.com.
This is the podcast.
Hi, everyone. I'm Ariel Cooksey, host of Malice. When violent acts occur, we tend to think the predators are monsters. Surely no human could do such things. But if we're honest, only humans commit malicious crime. And if you're like me, you want to know why. To find out, join me at Malice, wherever you listen to podcasts. Bye.
Yeah. Did I know you were doing this one?
Huh?
Did I know you were doing that, him?
I think so. I don't know. That's the name I said in the chat.
Oh, I didn't remember that. He pops up in my story.
Oh, interesting.
Oh, cool. So I lost my train of thought.
Uh-oh.
Sorry. Sorry.
Yeah. Oh. Who do we? I think we just lost Nina's there or something.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Oh. You know, I don't know if he.
Nina, we lost you just for a second. And you want to just back up the sentence?
Yeah.
Uh-oh. You're frozen, shit. Nina. All right, we'll just have to wait for Nina.
Hi.
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 Sorry. Yeah, my internet cut out. What was the last part that I said?
Yeah.
fuck.
Yeah. What was the sentence you were saying? Was I going next or was CJ going next? I can't remember already.
Well, I thought you were going first.
I can go before you. Yeah, no problem. I just can't remember.
No, I thought you were going very first.
No, no.
And then you made Nina go.
Mike doesn't like going first ever, so. Yeah.
I need to get some beer in me first.
That means you're a bottom, not a top, right?
Oh, man.
I don't need to know.
You okay, Nina? No.
Honestly, I'm sweating ball sacks. I'm going to go tie my hair up and take my pants off.
Should have been wearing a hat.
Right?
Fail.
I could get used to this recording while laying on my couch.
We could hook up the mic.
Except that Homer won't stop bothering me.
Yeah, well, you know, we could always hook up the mic at the couch instead.
No.
Oh, how the hell do you pronounce her last name? And this is the one called commercial, Nina?
Mm-hmm.
That's the audio for this part.
Oh, shit. Yeah. Just kidding. I'm ready.
No worries. We edit it anyways, and it sounds like you're ready.
In this time on Rolle, Nano.
Yeah. This is Ducky Audio 1.
Yeah, just blowing it up.
No worries.
it's thinking.
Nina.
Doing the na na
na na na
na na. I'm a shark. That's a crocodile.
Baby shark.
No.
Are you there, CJ?
Can you hear me?
Now we can. Okay, good.
Hey.
Okay, I'm sorry. I had to plug my phone in. It was starting to die.
No worries. I suddenly noticed the screen went dark, and I'm like, something's not right here.
I'm still here, and I can kind of hear you. I have to have my ear up to the phone, though.
Oh, weird. Now I've got baby shark stuck in my fucking head. It sucks having nieces and nephews sometimes. It's like that goddamn Frozen soundtrack.
Don't you bring that up.
I've never even seen the movie, and I fucking hate it.
I've seen them, and I love them.
Okay.
The dog, or... So you said the last movie is All Dogs Go to Heaven?
That's just the movie. No, for Judith here.
I was like, I love puppies. Okay, just kidding. Yes.
Nina.
What's the name of the clip?
Ducky Audio 2. That's not my audio.
You bitch.
Sorry, I had that queued up. I'm like, I gotta fuck with you guys just a little bit. What was it called, Mike?
Ducky Audio 2.
That could have went in your episode about bad parents.
Oh, it could have, yes. Yeah, no, it's just like, yeah, my bad parents could have gone in the cult episode.
You're probably right. Sal starred as a stalker in a low budget, but oh my goodness.
Low budget, I love it.
A low budget.
Okay, I love the fact that you're on a walk again there, Beck.
Well, I'm making sure that truck is gone.
Going through the rainbow flags again.
Okay, fuck.
What? Oh, yeah.
Are you being stalked?
No.
No, someone's moving in our building.
Out front being very loud, and I was just making sure they were gone.
I just have roosters in my background. But you haven't heard them, have you?
No, no cocks yet.
Okay, good. Yeah, I don't do cocks. Okay.
Thank you for that.
bisexual burger. Because everybody knows
sexual burger.
I almost spit my beer out.
or five guys.
Everybody knows hamburgers have sexual orientations.
Yes. Hey, there's Five Guys burgers. So.
Is there pickles on it or not?
Okay, he landed a role as a not a burger. He's a burglar. I think it's Beck's turn.
It is. Yes.
Anybody wanting a break before I start?
Beck?
Yeah. Something wrong with my screens here. Just a sec.
No worries. It's just like I'm watching you kind of look at it and point.
Yeah. Well, on mine, everyone was frozen. So I was just trying to get it to go again. Yeah. We're good. Everyone's moving. You can cut this all out.
Yeah. Cut. Snip, snip, okay. Snip.
I think we just lost CJ.
Oh.
Yeah, I would hold on a second.
Yeah, hold that for a second.
Thanks, Nina.
Oh,
yeah, she just requested to join. I just logged her back in.
Yep.
Sorry.
No worries.
I don't know what happened. I just kind of went bye-bye.
No problem.
Can you do the sound clip, Nina?
I was going to say, I wasn't born until September 1990, so I'm a solid two. You know them. Okay, here's the clip, you old mark.
Unfortunately for him, the word was already out, and thanks to the national media, many people had already made... Do you guys hear that?
Yeah, what's the sound?
Yeah, there's an alien on the line.
Yeah. Maybe try that again, yeah.
Many people, such as... It's when I'm talking, right?
I can tell it's actually back... it is backing up on Nina's feed here, because I can suddenly see Nina's thing like light up. It might be the fact that you don't have headphones in. I don't know.
Do you want me to put headphones on?
Might not hurt. I don't know.
Or a
hat. Yeah. Probably the hat. Try that last little bit there, Beck. I don't know. Yeah.
I don't envy you for having to do all the editing, Mike.
I mean, there's always a lot of editing, but it's going to be a little harder for this, I think.
Yeah.
Whatever. Is that your
That's
pup?
Me. That's my dog. Aww. I think my roommate got an Amazon order. Stop. Move.
Okay. Bring us all back.
Yeah, I'm going to have to unplug my headphones to play because
yeah,
it's obviously
worries.
Not going to work.
Take your hat off.
No.